Dear friends, I am Dr. K. Kannan, Professor Mechanical Engineering, Anjali Ammal Mahalingam Engineering College, Kovilvundi. I am happy to meet you again in the video lecture on the subject Design of Transmission Systems. This is lecture number 11.1. So we are going to discuss on brake design. The topic will be discussed in this lecture are band and block brakes, external shoe brakes, internal and external shoe brakes. We recap from the earlier lecture. So, in the earlier lecture on this subject, design of transmission system, we discussed the design of belt drive, chain drive, rope drive, gear and gearbox design, also the clutch drive. And we solved few problems in all the designs using the PSG design data book. And in this lecture, we will be discussing the brake design. The learning outcome to the student at the end of the lecture, the student will be able to explain the working of block brake, band brake, band and block brake, and the internal expanding shoe brake. And the student will be able to calculate the braking torque of the block brake, band brake, band and the block brake, and the internal expanding shoe brake. So these are all the four important types of brakes which you will be designing in this lecture. So a brake is defined as a mechanical device which is used to absorb the energy possessed by a moving system or mechanism by means of friction. The terminology brake is very popular and it is well known to all the students in this mechanical engineering. Because everybody, we have some vehicle for our conveyance. In all the vehicles, either two wheeler or four wheeler, there is a brake. The purpose of the brake is to absorb energy possessed by the moving system or mechanism by means of friction. When you apply the brake, the vehicle is stopped. The primary purpose of the brake is to slow down or completely stop the motion of the moving system, such as rotating drum, machine or a vehicle. So the rotating drum, it is used in the mechanical system, and the machine, suppose a lathe machine is working, a drilling machine is working, a planing machine is working. So we want to stop the machine, so we apply the brake. Similarly, any vehicle, two wheeler or four wheeler, we want to stop, we apply the brake. The primary purpose of the brake is to slow down or stop, completely stop the motion of the moving system. An automobile brake is used either to reduce the speed of the car or to bring it to the rest position. The energy absorbed by the brake can be either kinetic energy or potential energy or both. In automobiles, the brake absorbs the kinetic energy. In hoist and elevator, the brake absorbs the potential energy released by the object during the braking period. The energy absorbed by the brake is converted into heat and it is dissipated to the surrounding. So any brake, when there is a friction, so the brake is applied, brake produces friction in the system. So the loss of energy due to friction is dissipated to the surrounding by means of heat. So the braking system should have provision for dissipating heat to the surrounding. So we classify the brake. There are different types of brake, mechanical brake. Mechanical brakes are further classified as block brake, internal or external shoe brake, disc brake or and band brake. And it may be also known as, we have another type, radial brake. So here internal and external shoe brakes are radial brake, and axial brake, disc brake is an axial brake. And the brake also applied by hydraulic power or pneumatic power. So they are called as hydraulic and pneumatic brakes. So using mechanical power, when you apply the brake, that is mechanical brake, when you use the hydraulic power or pneumatic power, pneumatic energy, then it is called as pneumatic or hydraulic brakes. Electric brake, so the using electric energy we apply the brake. So magnetic particle brake, hysteresis brake and the eddy current brake. So in thermal engineering laboratory, you would have used the eddy current dynamometer. So it is the dynamometer is applying brake to the engine system and thereby measuring the torque, measuring the brake power. So the to measure the brake power, we are using the eddy current dynamometer. So it is a kind of brake applied to the IC engine. The capacity of the brake depends on the unit pressure between the braking surfaces, the conducting area of the braking surface, the radius of the brake drum, coefficient of friction, and the ability of the brake to dissipate the heat. So these are all the important parameter or factor, so using which we are designing the brake capacity. The material used for brake lining should have the following characteristics. So any brake, we have a brake lining which will have direct contact with the rotating element, rotating part of the machine or the vehicle. So the material used for brake lining should have the following characteristics. It should be high, it should have high coefficient of friction with the minimum fading. In other words, the coefficient of friction should be remain constant over the entire surface with a change in the temperature. So because when you apply the brake, the friction, due to the friction there will be heat is generated and the heat will be absorbed by the lining material. So because of the heat, the coefficient of friction should not change. So the coefficient of friction should be constant for the change in temperature. It should have low wear rate. It should have high heat resistance. It should have high heat dissipation capacity. So the thermal conductivity should be higher. So the material should have higher thermal conductivity so that it will dissipate the heat energy quickly. It should have low coefficient of thermal expansion. So it will not expand because of the temperature. So low coefficient of expansion. So because when it expands, without applying the brake, the lining material will hit the rotating element. So it will apply the brake. And it should have adequate mechanical strength. It should be strong enough to withstand the force. And it should not affected, it should not be affected by the moisture and the oil. So moisture in the atmosphere or oil in the system, it should not affect the quality of the lining material. So these are all the desirable properties of the material used for brake lining. The amount of energy absorbed by the brake, so we will calculate the amount of energy absorbed by the brake. So first the kinetic energy, the kinetic energy absorbed by the brake for translation. So K equal to 1 by 2 M into V1 square minus V2 square. And kinetic energy absorbed by the brake for rotation. So kinetic energy equal to 1 by 2 M K square omega 1 M K square into omega 1 square minus omega 2 square, where K is the radius of gyration of the body and omega is the angular velocity. And potential energy absorbed by the brake, P E equal to MGH. So M is mass, G is the acceleration due to gravity, H is the height. So the braking torque MT, it is given by the total energy absorbed by the brake divided by the angle through which the brake drum rotated during the braking period in radians. That is the braking torque. And first we calculate the braking torque of a single block brake. So look at the diagram. So there is a rotating drum. So in the first diagram, the drum is rotating in the clockwise direction. And in the second diagram, the drum is rotating in the anti-clockwise direction. Wheel or the drum is rotating in the anti-clockwise direction. We have a single block. So radially mounted block. It is the block which is rubbing. So when you pull the lever downward, so the block will have the contact with the wheel and the wheel will be stopped or slowed down. And we have a lever, braking lever. So the block is attached to the braking lever. And the one end of the braking lever is hinged here. O is the point of hinge. And here the center of the wheel. So we have the normal reaction perpendicular to direction, perpendicular upward. it is acting at the center of the brake, center of the block, and we have the total length of the lever L, and x is the distance of the center of the block, center of the wheel from the O. So these are all the dimensions. P is the force which is applied, and Ft is the tangential force. Ft is the tangential force. P is the force, braking force, which is applied to the block. And similarly, this is the anti-clockwise direction. So the Ft, the frictional force, the tangential force acting in the opposite direction, and other parameters remains the same. So the assumptions for the calculation in the single block brake: the block is rigidly attached to the lever. The angle of contact between the block and the brake drum is small, resulting uniform pressure distribution. So the angle of contact 2 theta is the angle of contact, which is small. We assume that is small. If it is larger, we have to calculate the coefficient of friction. So the brake drum is rotating in clockwise direction. So first we take the clockwise direction and we calculate the forces. So P is the force applied at the end of the lever. Rn is the normal force, a normal reaction pressing of the normal force pressing the brake block on the wheel. R is the radius of the wheel, small r. 2 theta is the angle of contact of the surface of the block. Mu is the coefficient of friction, and Ft is the tangential braking force or frictional force acting at the contact surface of the block and the wheel. If the angle of contact is less than 30 degree, then it may be assumed that the normal pressure distribution between the pressure between the block and the wheel is uniform. In such a cases, the tangential braking force on the wheel, Ft equal to mu into Rn. So the braking torque equal to Ft into R. So tangential force into radius of the brake drum. So mu Rn into small r. Small r is the radius of the braking wheel. So the braking torque for clockwise direction, clockwise rotation, is mu Rn to R, small r. And the case 1, so we take three different cases in the calculation. When the line of action of the tangential force Ft passes through the fulcrum O of the lever and the brake wheel rotates clockwise direction as shown in the figure, then for equilibrium, taking moment about the fulcrum O. So look at the diagram. Fulcrum O, this is when the line of action of the tangential force Ft passes through the fulcrum O. So this is the line of action. The line of action merges with the O. Then the brake wheel rotates in the clockwise direction. So the brake wheel is rotating in the clockwise direction. The line of action of the tangential force is merging with the fulcrum O. So in that case, we have to take the moment. So Rn into x. So Rn is the normal force into x is the distance at which it is acting from the fulcrum. That is equal to P, the pulling force into the L. So the Rn equal to PL by X. Now the braking torque. So we have already braking torque equal to mu Rn into small r. So mu into PL by X into R. It may be noted that when the brake wheel rotates in the anti-clockwise direction, then the braking torque is the same. So whether this clockwise direction or anti-clockwise direction, the braking torque is going to be the same, mu into PL divided by X into R. R is the radius of the brake drum, X is the position, center of the wheel from the fulcrum, and L is the length of the lever, mu is the coefficient of friction. And case 2, now when the line of action of the tangential braking force Ft passes through at a distance A below the fulcrum. So look at the configuration once again. So fulcrum is O is the center of the fulcrum. This is the line of action of the tangential force, and it is A, small distance below the fulcrum center. So O is, from O it is at a distance A. Now we take the moment about the fulcrum O, Rn into X. So Rn into the X distance plus Ft into A. So Ft into A, that is equal to P into L. So P is the force, pulling force, downward force, multiplied by the total length from the center O, and Ft into A is the distance gap between O and the line of action. So R into X, so we substitute for Ft. Ft equal to mu into Rn into A. So Rn into X plus mu into Rn into A equal to P into L. So Rn into X plus mu A equal to P into L. So rearranging Rn, normal reaction or normal force equal to PL divided by X plus mu into A. That is the normal reaction force. Now we calculate the braking torque. TB equal to mu Rn into small r. That is equal to mu into PL divided by X plus mu A into small r, radius of the brake torque. And when the brake wheel rotate in the anti-clockwise direction, then for equilibrium, Rn into X equal to PL plus Ft into A. So the Ft A, it goes to the right side. So PL plus mu Rn A. So this will become, rearranging the Rn terms, Rn into X minus mu A equal to PL. So Rn equal to PL by X minus mu A. Now the braking torque TB equal to mu into Rn into small r, that is equal to mu into PL, substituting for Rn from the previous expression, mu into PL divided by X minus mu A into small r. That is the braking torque. And we take the case 3. So case 3, diagrammatically it is shown here. So the line of action, so fulcrum is O here and line of action some distance above. So A is the distance above, the line of action is at a distance A above the center of the fulcrum. That is what the definition. When the line of action of the tangential braking force Ft passes through at a distance A above the fulcrum O, the brake wheel rotates clockwise direction as shown in the figure. Then for equilibrium, taking moment about the fulcrum O. So taking the moment, Rn into X equal to PL plus Ft into A. So look at here, the vertical force Rn multiplied by the X distance A plus Ft multiplied by Rn multiplied by X, Ft multiplied by A, and the pressure force, I mean the pulling force P multiplied by the length L. So calculating Rn into X equal to PL plus Ft into A. So we know Ft equal to mu into Rn. So Rn into X minus mu Rn into A equal to PL. So Rn into X minus mu A equal to P into L. So then rearranging the terms, Rn equal to PL by X minus mu A. And the braking torque TB equal to mu into Rn into small r. So substituting for Rn from the previous expression, so mu equal to PL by X minus mu A into R. That is the braking torque. So when the brake wheel rotates anticlockwise as shown in the figure B, so this is the B diagram B, when the wheel is rotating in the anticlockwise direction, then for equilibrium, taking moment about the fulcrum O, so the braking torque TB equal to mu Rn into small r. So the now Rn will be PL by X plus mu A. So the minus sign in the previous equation is replaced by plus because the wheel is rotating in the anticlockwise direction. So mu PL divided by X plus mu A into R, radius of the brake drum. And from above discussion, so we have this discussion. So we have one TB equation here, we have one TB equation. So from the equation, we have Rn into X equal to PL plus mu Rn into A. So from this, we see that moment of frictional force, which is mu Rn A, adds to the moment of the force Pi. So Rn into X equal to Pi into mu Rn into A. So mu Rn into A is the moment of the frictional force added to the Pi. P into L is the moment of the force which is applied for the brake. Now, in other words, the frictional force helps to apply the brake. Such a type of brake is said to be self-energizing brake. When the frictional force is great enough to apply the brake with no external force, then the brake is said to be self-locking brake. So, from the above expression, so here we take this expression once again. If we see, if X is less than or equal to mu A, x is less than or equal to mu a, then, so for example, x is equal to mu a, x equal to mu a, these two are equal, then p will be negative or equal to 0. This means no external force is needed to apply the brake, and hence the brake is self-locking. Therefore, the condition of the brake is to be self-locking is x is less than or equal to mu a. Look at the equation. When x equal to mu into a, p will be equal to 0, because p will be equal to 0 or negative, so p will be equal to 0. So when p equal to 0, without applying the force, the brake will be applied. That is called as self-locking brake. So the condition for self-locking is x value, the distance x value is should be less than or equal to mu a. So self-locking brake is used only in the backstop applications. Brake should be self-energizing, not self-locking. So we have to apply some energy, we have to give some force, there should be some magnitude for p. So when p equal to 0, it is called a self-locking brake, and the brake should not be self-locking brake, it should be self-energizing brake. In order to avoid the self-locking and to prevent the brake from grabbing, x is kept greater than mu a. So the x value should be more than mu into a. So a is the distance and mu is the coefficient of friction, and the x value should be greater than mu into a. Then only we have to apply some force, apply some value p. The p will be some positive value, and that will be used for applying the brake. So next we will be discussing about the double block or shoe brake. So instead of a single block, we will have double block. So block on both sides, and we have a lever and a spring, and the bell crank lever is used to apply the brake. When you pull the, there is a fulcrum. So fulcrum is the point of center point. So about the fulcrum, we can move the bell crank lever. So by moving the bell crank lever, the brake will be applied. So the two, actually here we have the hinges. So the drum will be rotating in the clockwise or the anti-clockwise direction. When you apply the force here, downward force, the two lever will come closer, and the brake, the block or the shoe of the brake will make contact with the rotating drum, and the block, the brake will be applied. So here the braking torque is given by TB equal to FT1 plus FT2 into R. So FT1 is the tangential force on the left side, and tangential force FT2 is the tangential force on the right side. So FT1, FT2 are the braking forces on the two blocks, and R is the radius of the brake drum. The main consideration in the block brake design, the location of the pivot for the brake lever or brake arm, namely dimension of A and C, is very important in the single block brake. The coefficient of friction, so we should have sufficient coefficient of friction so that the brake will be applied effectively, and the direction of rotation, whether this is clockwise direction or anti-clockwise direction. So these are all the design consideration of the shoe brake or the block brake. We stop here. So other types of brake we will discuss in the next lecture, and these are all the books I published in mechanical engineering subject. And I upload the video lectures of all the subjects in the YouTube channel. You subscribe the channel, use the video lectures for your better learning. So thank you for watching. Please post your comments on the comments box. You can contact me through my mail ID or WhatsApp number for any clarification on the subject. So we'll meet again in another video lecture. We continue the brake design in the next lecture.